Pakistan. Honorable retired inspectors general who have been a source of great inspiration as well as guidance for us in the Police Reforms Committee. Their experience has really shown us the way, and we are ever so grateful to them for their time, for their effort, and for their input. The other members of the police force who have gathered here from all over the province of Punjab, respectable media persons, families of the Shohada, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. My association with the police dates back to the year 1976, when I was a student and my eldest brother, Mr. Tariq Khosa, joined the Punjab police. And as he progressed in his profession in the police department, we also had greater and greater involvement through him, till such time that in the year 1989, I had a direct interaction with the police when I was invited to speak to the under-training officers at the National Police Academy, Islamabad. And that was a year when I didn't know that after so many years, this year will come back to me. And I recall that some of the under-training officers in that 1989 batch, and I had the privilege to address them on that occasion, they are now the senior-most police officers in the entire country, and some of them are inspectors general in different provinces, and some of them are present in this ceremony today. My third interaction with police has been throughout my career as a lawyer and my career as a judge. I had been dealing with criminal cases most of the times, and in every criminal case, it's the working of the police which comes in issue, and then you start developing an insight, not only as how police works, but what are the pitfalls in the working of the police, which are the areas which need improvement. And then I was very fortunate when I came to this office, to this job, then a police reforms committee had already been constituted by my very honorable predecessor, Mr. Justice Mia Saqib Nisar, the then Honorable Chief Justice of Pakistan. So I inherited this position as the chairman of the Police Reforms Committee. But immediately after coming into this office, we got going with the help of the retired inspectors general and the serving inspectors general. And ever since, we have remained quite busy and we have launched a number of initiatives. As the Chief Justice, I have launched many initiatives, not only in the police department, but in the information technology, as far as the Supreme Court and High Courts are concerned. Then we have launched model courts for expeditious delivery of justice in criminal cases. We have also established gender-based violence courts. And I'll focus mainly today on whatever we have been trying to do in the police department and in the criminal justice sector from that angle. But before I come to that, I want to share with you that my first priority when I became the Chief Justice was to restore dignity of all those who appear before courts. Not only the litigants, but also the officers of different departments, and particularly the officers belonging to the police department. As a judge of the High Court, and then as a judge of the Supreme Court, I had personally witnessed some incidents in which officials coming to the courts at different times, I'm not blaming anybody, but this was the prevalent practice, that somehow the officials appearing before the courts were not treated with that much dignity as they deserved. And sometimes the situation was absolutely unbearable. And hats off to the members of the police who belonged to a disciplined force. They never responded. They just bore with it. They just lived with it and kept on showing respect and dignity to the court, and as was expected. So my first priority was that we should ensure that a court works as a court, and anybody appearing before the court, and particularly members of a disciplined force, once they appear, they should be afforded due dignity and respect, whatever be the nature of the case, whatever be the circumstances of a case. The dignity, which is a fundamental right under Article 14 of the Constitution, cannot be violated. The Constitution says dignity of man is inviolable. And I'm going to share something with you which so far nobody knows except the Supreme Judicial Council, that one very senior judge of the High Court was preceded by the Supreme Judicial Council only on the allegation that he had humiliated and insulted a police official in the court proceedings. So that was a message that we sent straight away, that everybody is to be entitled to dignity, and whatever be his calling, whatever be his job, once he appears in the court, he is to be accorded due respect and treated with dignity. That we have already achieved to greater extent, and incidents of officers being treated rashly or not properly have reduced to a great extent, and we are still looking into it, that no such incident takes place at all, not just with police officers, but with anybody who appears in a court of law or anywhere else. As the Police Reforms Committee is concerned, I'll also, before that, I'll tell you another thing, that ever since I became the Chief Justice, whenever something happened in the country which took notice of the public at large, there was an outcry that the Chief Justice should take suo motu notice. I realized that because of the activism of some of my very respectable seniors, the departments themselves were already on toes. And whenever any incident took place, immediately all the concerned officials would reach the spot, respond to the situation, take the matter into hands. And this is what the court was expected to do, even if a notice had been taken by the court, that those officials, those departments were to be activated by the court, but the real work was to be done by the court, by those officials themselves. So if the officials are already efficient, if they are already doing their job, if they're already attending to an emerging situation, then there was no need for the court to jump in. There were times when an incident would take place in the evening. During night time, a notice was taken by the court. And in the morning, all the senior officers would be running to Islamabad to appear before the Supreme Court, rather than going to the place of occurrence and attending to the situation that had been created. So that, I thought, was not correct. And if the officials are not responding, if the situation is not being tackled, then somebody has to nudge them, somebody had to activate them. Yes, in such a situation it could be justified that the court intervenes. But now that whenever any incident takes place, all the senior officers everywhere in every concerned department are active, even in matters relating to police. The IGs, the DIGs, and everybody is active, and the political administration executive also intervenes and they are active. So there was hardly any need for the Supreme Court to jump in at a premature stage, particularly when the Supreme Court is a court of last resort. How can it be it afford to become the court of first resort, a matter, an institution of first resort? Now something had to ripen up, something has to mature, then investigation is to take place, trial is to take place, appeal is to take place, and then the matter will come to the Supreme Court. And if we interfere on day one, then the whole process of justice will be retarded. That will be reversed, and that's never conducive to the interests of justice. I have seen some cases, I've handled some cases in which many years ago some notices were taken on some incidents, and it was declared at that time by the Supreme Court that this is a case of terrorism and an FIR should be registered and trial should take place on the basis of such a declaration by the Supreme Court. Later on it transpired that the case was merely a case of private enmity or a private grievance. So it was argued before us when the matter came up in appeal that this is not a case of terrorism, and our hands were tied. We could not say that it's not a case of terrorism because a judgment had already been rendered right after the incident by the Supreme Court that yes, it is a case of terrorism. So such premature intervention, I was of the opinion that it is ill-advised. So as far as I am concerned, I have exercised restraint in the matter and have not bothered any other department so far, if the department itself is already actively engaged in the matter. Now coming to the Police Reforms Committee, we have launched many initiatives, but the most important, which affects the population in at large, is the police complaints mechanism, and the SP complaints were installed in every district throughout the country, and I'm so grateful to the inspectors general who have fully cooperated and have spared an SP in every district to attend to the people's grievances straight away before people have to have resort to a court of law for redressal of their grievance. In this respect, the results are absolutely unbelievable. People immediately took a liking for this new forum that we had created. People didn't have to go to court. People didn't have to spend money on resolution of their grievance. And then I'm told the figures given to us only a few hours ago in the Police Reforms Committee meeting was that so far 1,20,000 complaints have already been attended to by the SP complaints. And out of those complaints, about 95% of the people have gone satisfied and they didn't go to any court for redressal of their grievances, with the net result that within these few months, 100,000 more cases would have been added to the courts, which did not come to the courts because the grievance was redressed at another forum and the appropriate forum. So this is one great success at serving the people in a befitting manner, that within the police department itself there is a mechanism for redressal of grievances, and only those who are dissatisfied with such a recourse, then they can go to the court and the court can attend to their grievance. The other thing which is worth mentioning in this context is that in the high courts, 15% lesser writ petitions, number of writ petitions have been filed in the high courts throughout the country. And in the district judiciary, 30% lesser number of complaints or petitions filed before the district judiciary against the police within this short span of time. Now 15% or 30% is a huge number when you consider that we are talking about population of 22 crores. Then 30% reduction in the high courts, is in the district judiciary, is a phenomenal figure, and we are so proud that our police has responded to the necessity, reducing the burden on the courts. And the courts had more time to attend to those real issues which deserve to be attended by the courts.
चीफ जस्टिस ऑफ पाकिस्तान जस्टिस आसिफ सईद खोसा लाहौर में तकरीब से खिताब कर रहे हैं। उन्होंने कहा कि रिटायर्ड पुलिस अफसरान ने भी पुलिस इस्लाहात कमेटी में अहम किरदार अदा किया है। बतौर वकील और जज पुलिस के साथ मेरा ताल्लुक हमेशा बहुत बेहतर रहा। चीफ जस्टिस बनने पर अव्वलीन तरजीह अदालतों में पेश होने वालों का वकार बरकरार रखना था और उनकी जानिब से यह भी कहा गया कि केस की नौइयत कुछ भी हो, डिसिप्लिन फोर्स के पेश होने वालों का एहतराम जरूरी है।
Were constituted throughout the country, and they were manned not only by some retired sessions judge, some practicing lawyers, some other officers belonging to the police, and they would assess every month as to why in so many cases in that district anybody was acquitted. There must be a reason mentioned in the judgment, and why bails were granted in some cases where the prosecution thought that those cases were not fit for bail. The result of deliberations of the district assessment committee would be then presented to the local police heads, whoever they are, and then the results of deliberations of that committee would trickle down or be conveyed to the investigating officers, so that in future cases the investigating officers do not repeat the same mistake. So this mechanism is already in place. It has started showing results, and in the last meeting of the police reforms committee, the inspector general of police Islamabad had informed us that the crime rate has already started coming down. So this is the result, that previous mistakes are not repeated, and for future purposes the investigations are conducted on the lines which are acceptable to the courts. The evidence is produced in the court which is acceptable, not rejected out of hand, because people the investigating officer did not even know what mistakes he was committing. So he would be made aware of the mistakes being committed by him, and next time he would be expected not to commit those mistakes. So this again is a very positive development, and it will lead to more convictions in future, and we hope that this experiment will be expanded throughout the country, which it has started in the country, and it will be expanded in due course. The third aspect in which the police has been of great help is establishment of model courts. We have established model courts in every district of the country, and initially they started trials of murder cases and narcotics cases, and again the results are absolutely unbelievable. Only because the police has been cooperating with us so much. The main things that we did in the model courts was, it's the same judges, same lawyers, same courtrooms, same law, same procedure. Only through some administrative measures we have fine-tuned the system and eliminated all possibilities of an adjournment of a case. Now, the first and foremost reason for adjournment was that even in a state case, even in a challan case, it was the complainant who would bring his witnesses. And on one date of hearing, the complainant would say, I've been able to bring two witnesses. On the next date of hearing, he would say, none has come with me. They're busy reaping their harvest, or they're busy irrigating their lands, or somebody was ill and he couldn't bring. He didn't have any influence on his witnesses. So the first major thing that we emphasized vis-a-vis the police's role in this respect was that we said, no, in a state case, it is the responsibility of the state to produce witnesses. So the inspectors general, and we're so grateful to them, they undertook this. Focal persons were appointed in every district, that the court would tell the focal persons that so-and-so and so-and-so, son of so-and-so, resident of so-and-so, is to be produced before the court on such and such date. He is a prosecution witness. It is the police now which brings those people, and as you can imagine, nobody can say no to the police. So every witness is present, and there is no adjournment. The other things that we did may not be relevant to you, but very briefly I would say that instead of a rollover system, that the court is dealing with 50 cases at the same time, And every day there is a list of 15 or 20 cases in which the trial court has to make some progress. So he would record one witness's statement in one case, adjourn it to another month, and then take up another case, record two witnesses in the other case, decide a bail application, decide a transfer application, and some miscellaneous work, and then the cases would roll on together. We changed that. We said, no, only one case at a time. And once the case starts, the next case will be taken up when this case finishes. So a scheduling of case is undertaken by the judges, the lawyers of both the sides, as well as the prosecution and the police representative. They are present. Within their presence, it is decided that on such and such dates the witnesses will be produced, on such and such date the accused will be given a chance to rebut them, on such and such date the arguments will be heard, and decision shall be announced on that date. And this is meticulously being adhered to. We knew that all these lawyers, the learned counsel who appear in murder cases or narcotics cases, because these are very important cases, they are senior advocates. And a senior advocate would be having cases before the High Court or the Supreme Court also on the same dates. So we announced through the judicial policy making body that once a case is scheduled by the trial judge, then a scheduling certificate will be issued. And if a scheduling certificate is presented before the High Court or the Supreme Court and the High Court will adjourn the hearing. Before those courts, trial court proceedings shall not be adjourned. So this has brought about miraculous results, and I'm very happy to share with you that model courts in the last 189 days, they have decided 24,523 murder and narcotics cases. 189 days, 24,523 trials. They are not appeals that can be heard in one day and decided. They are trials, and you know, being in police, how long a trial can take and what steps are to be taken. It is absolutely unbelievable. Then we extended this to the magistrates' courts. In the last 106 days that these magistrates' model courts were created, 27,469 trials have been concluded by the magistrates. And this, again, is absolutely unbelievable. Now, something that is very fascinating to achieve and then to inform, and I would be very happy to inform you, that as far as criminal cases are concerned, in these 189 days, we have achieved zero pendency of murder trials in 18 districts in the country. I can name those: Dera Bukti, Bar Khan, Dalbandin, Harnai, Kalat, Killa Saifullah, Kohlu, Mastong, Turbat, Panjgur, Kharan, Noshki, Ziyarat, Tharparkar, Tando Mahmud Khan, Koistan Lower, Batagram, Koistan Upper. And there are six district headquarters in which zero pendency of murder cases: Chiniot, Hafizabad, Jhelum, Lodhra, Bahawalnagar, Laya, some very heavy stations. But it's only because of the dedication of our judges and fullest possible cooperation by the police that this has been achieved, which was absolutely unthinkable only a few months ago. Narcotics trials, in 189 days, 25 districts now have zero pendency of narcotics trials. This is complete district, all tehsils. Then there are 11 other district headquarters where zero pendency has been achieved: Bahawalpur, Bakhar, Chakwal, Chiniot, Hafizabad, Jampur, Rajanpur, Jhelum, Kachhi, and Lodhra, Shekhupura, and Laya. There are 8 other tehsils where zero pendency has been achieved. So likewise, magistrates' trials, many, many districts now have zero magisterial trials, and this has been achieved only because of the help of the police and the dedication of our judges. But somebody had to take the initiative, and hats off to the inspectors general who agreed with us, and this is something which is worth doing, and they have extended us fullest possible cooperation. Sometimes, you know, every day I receive regular updates about these model codes, and sometimes my monitoring team says in such and such district the police did not produce witnesses before the model judge. So my monitoring team immediately contacts the either the Inspector General of that province or the concerned DIG, and such a complaint is immediately attended to and redressed straight away. And we have absolutely no complaints on that. With this zero pendency of criminal cases, murder cases and narcotics, and also we have attended to, for the magisterial trials, 489F cases, dishonored checks. I was surprised to know that thousands and thousands of such cases are pending before magistrates for the last many, many years, and no progress had been made, and money belonging to businessmen and others was stuck. So when we started this drive, I have been told that till yesterday about 100 crores of rupees have been recovered and given to the person whose check issued in his favor was dishonored. So 100 crores of rupees going back to the persons who deserved that, and it can help their businesses and their whole life will be on rails again. So this is how crime is reduced. Now whenever such a case is taken up, before the trial starts, the accused says, I am ready to pay. And the purpose is served and the case is finished. So this is the spirit. This is the effect of taking up all these matters on such a fast track, that people can delay their liabilities, they can postpone their liabilities if they know that the justice system will not respond quickly. But if they know that the justice system is going to respond quickly, then they are more prone to settle the issue straight away. And you'll be surprised that all these about 77,000 trials that have so far been conducted and concluded by the model courts throughout the country in different murder, narcotics and magisterial trials, almost ₹1 billion of fines have already been imposed upon all those who were convicted. So when this money will be realized, I'm sure that will be our humble contribution to the beleaguered economy of the country. So these fines have to go to the state treasury, the government treasury. So these fines will add to our coffers in the treasury. There are some other things that we have done in the recent past. Some judgments have been handed down, clearing out the gray areas in law. Like the definition of terrorism, there was litigation, a case would come to the trial court, and a side litigation would travel right up to Supreme Court to determine as to whether this is a case of terrorism or not. So we have clarified that issue, and I'm sure that confusion in that regard will no more haunt the courts. Then we have clarified the law relating to holding of test identification parades. We have already clarified the law about multiple FIRs being lodged in one case. And then falsus in uno, falsus in omnibus. Falsus in uno means false in one respect, false in all respects. This is a principle in Islamic law. This is a principle in the entire civilized world, that if a witness lies on one particular aspect in a criminal case, then his entire testimony is to be discarded. Unfortunately, in the year 1951, one of the Honorable Chief Justices of Lahore High Court at that time, his lordship held that in this part of the world, people are prone to telling lies, and if we start throwing out their statements because some part of it is false, then everybody will be acquitted. So expediency demands that we should allow him to make a false statement, and later on it will be for the court to determine as to how much of the statement is to be believed and how much of the statement is not to be believed. This was absolutely atrocious because this was like giving a license to tell lies under oath. This license was used, this license was abused, and with the result that today there are no qualms as far as the witnesses are concerned. They are ready to take oath. कि सच कहूँगा सच के सिवा कुछ नहीं कहूँगा और ये कह के सब झूठ. एक उसमें मुलजम असली होता है, उसके दादा को, उसके चचा को, उसके बाप को, उसके वालदा को, उसकी नानी को, सबको मुलजम बना देते. सो एंड द कोर्ट्स वर वेरी कन्वीनियंटली दे वुड एक्सेप्ट ऑल सच टेस्टिमनीज, दे वुड सिफ्ट, एंड देन आफ्टर ए डिले ऑफ 3 to 5 years when the case is decided, all those innocent people are sometimes acquitted and the real one is convicted. We said no more false witnesses in the courts. Ki half uthaya hai to galat bayan dena bazaat khud ek jurm hai, perjury, jis pe 15 sections hai PPC mein. Ki how can a court of law allow that, yes, okay, go ahead, tell lies. We said no, this can't be done, and this is against Islamic law, this is against the civilized law, and we have brought that principle back. So now greater responsibility lies on the investigating officers, kyunki ye ho nahi sakta ki investigating officer ko pata na ho ki ye jhoota gawah hai. Koi bhi waqia ho jaye, kehte hain ki ji ye वो दुकानदारों के सामने हुआ था, बाजार ने सब ने देखा था, लेकिन जी गवाह नहीं बनते, तो देखें अब कि मुलजम को तो किसी सजा दिलवानी है, तो वो उसका चचा जो 70 किलोमीटर दूर रहता है वो इत्तफाक से वहाँ से गुजर रहा था और जो उसने वाकया देख लिया. ऐसे झूठ जबकि तफ्तीशी अफसर को पता है कि झूठ है, तो ये तफ्तीशी अफसर की जिम्मेवारी है, क्योंकि अगर इंसाफ करना है तो फिर कानून के मुताबिक और इन अदल के जो भी मेयार हैं मज़हब में भी और कवानीन में भी, उनके बगैर इंसाफ नहीं हो सकता. अगर आप एक इंसाफ को अचीव करने के लिए 10 जरायम और कराते हैं, परजरी, अगर 10 गवाहों ने आके झूठ बोला है तो उन जरायम का जिम्मेवार कौन है? तफ्तीशी अफसर. सो वी हैव डिसाइडेड दैट इन सच केसेस, इस वक्त तकरीबन 15 के करीब गवाह ऐसे हैं जिनको हमने परजरी के ट्रायल के लिए रेफ़र कर चुके हैं ताकि दूसरों के लिए मिसाल हो, और अब हमने ये फैसला किया है कि इंशाल्लाह आइंदा के केसेस में तफ्तीशी अफसर को भी उतना ही हम मुलजम बनाएंगे कि इसने परजरी में मदद की है. अगर ये तो कोई इंसाफ दिलाना नहीं है, एक इंसाफ दिलाने के लिए जिसको एक जुर्म हुआ है उसके 10 जरायम आपके अंडर योर नोज एंड विद योर ब्लेसिंग्स वो आप 10 जरायम खुद कराएं, ये नहीं हो सकता. तो इसका नतीजा यही होगा कि शायद 2-4 साल कुछ लोगों को फ़ायदा हो जाए, उसके बाद जब मुआशरे तक ये खबर पहुंचेगी कि अब झूठा गवाह नहीं चलता, तो फिर या इंसाफ मांगना छोड़ देंगे अगर सच बोलने की हिम्मत नहीं है गवाहों में, या फिर इंसाफ मांगेंगे तो ऐसी सच्ची गवाही आएगी कि कोई बरी नहीं हो सकेगा, क्योंकि सच में बड़ी ताकत होती है. आई वॉन्ट टू कन्वे टूडे दैट ऑल दीज एफर्ट्स आर ओके, आर वेरी गुड, they serves of some purpose, but at the end of the day, what is the purpose of having a police? Number one, to nab a criminal, and number two, to create a situation where people don't commit crimes. But if the police itself supports commission of crime of perjury, then how can that system be just? To ye aap ek muahida kar le sab ki ye nahi hum karenge. बरी होते हैं तो हो जाए, अगर कोई झूठ, अगर कोई सच्चा गवाह नहीं गवाही देने जाता, अगर उसमें इसमें हिम्मत नहीं है, क्योंकि अल्लाह ताला का हुक्म क्या है, हम इस्लामिक ममलकत हैं, ममलकत खुदा दादे इस्लाम पाकिस्तान जो है इसके आइन कहते हैं कि इस्लाम शैल बी द स्टेट रिलीजन. अल्लाह ताला का हुक्म है कि सच्ची गवाही दो, चाहे वो तुम्हारे अपने खिलाफ हो, चाहे तुम्हारे वालदैन के खिलाफ हो, चाहे तुम्हारे अजीज़ अकरबा के खिलाफ हो. तो हम कैसे कह दें कि जी सच्चा गवाह तो हिम्मत नहीं रही उसको, तो इसलिए हम झूठे गवाह से काम चलाएंगे? काम चलाना मकसद नहीं है, कानून के मुताबिक इंसाफ अचीव करना मकसद है. अगर इंसाफ को अचीव करने के लिए जुर्म करना पड़ता है तो ऐसा इंसाफ इंसाफ नहीं है जो मुआशरे को करप्ट कर रहा है, इंसाफ नहीं हो सकता. ایک شخص کو انصاف دیتے ہوئے معاشرے کو سارے کو کرپٹ کر دیا. تو آج آپ ہمت کریں, فیصلہ کر لیں کہ آپ تو کی تو جاب ہی ہے کہ لوگوں کو قانون پر عمل کروانا ہے آپ نے, تو قانون پر عمل کراتے کراتے غیر قانونی کام آپ کے ہوتے ہوئے آپ کے قلم سے کیسے نکل کے جاتا ہے؟ جب چلان میں آپ وٹنسز لکھتے ہیں, کون سا تفتیشی افسر ہے جس کو نہیں پتا ہوتا کہ یہ گواہ امپورٹڈ گواہ ہے, یہ پلانٹڈ گواہ ہے؟ بلکہ وہ سجیسٹ کرتا ہے کہ وہ گواہ لے کے آؤ. ان وٹنسڈ اکرنس ہے تو دو گواہ وج ٹکر کے بنانے ہیں, دو گواہ ہم نے بنانے ہیں جی لاسٹ سین کے, یہ دو گواہ ریکوری کے بنانے ہیں, یہ لے کے آؤ. وہ پانچ چھ رشتے دار وہ پھر آ جاتے ہیں عدالت میں کہ سچ کے سوا کچھ نہیں کہوں گا, اور پھر سچ کے سوا سب کچھ کہنا کہتے ہیں. سب کو, کورٹ کو بھی نظر آ رہا ہے, سب کو نظر آ رہا ہے کہ یہ پلانٹڈ وٹنس ہے. ان دی لارجر انٹرسٹ آف ڈوئنگ جسٹس, یہ اچھی انصاف ہے جھوٹ کے اوپر بیسڈ ہو؟ تو اگر ایسا انصاف ہے تو پھر دیر از اے پرابلم, کیونکہ ایک کیس میں انصاف کرتے کرتے سارے معاشرے میں ناانصافی پھیلا دیں آپ. تو یہ تہیا کر لیں کہ آج سے ہم نے یہ غلط کام نہیں کرنا, چاہے جو مرضی ہو جائے. اگر کسی نے گواہی دینے کی ہمت نہیں ہے تو نہ مانگے انصاف. آپ کا کام کنوکشن اچیو کرنا نہیں ہے, آپ کا کام ہے کنوکشن اکارڈنگ ٹو لا. ہمارا کام انصاف کرنا نہیں ہے, ہمارا کام ہے انصاف کرنا قانون کے مطابق. یہ ہماری اوتھ ہے, آئین میں لکھا ہوا ہے, آئی شیل ڈو جسٹس اکارڈنگ ٹو لا. چاہے مجھے نظر بھی آ رہا ہے کہ اس نے قتل کیا ہے, اگر قانون میں نہیں ثابت ہوتا, اٹس مائی ڈیوٹی ٹو ایکوئٹ. اللہ تعالیٰ کے اس کا نظام بھی یہی ہے. اللہ تعالیٰ کے ایک جرم کے بارے میں کہتے ہیں چار گواہ لاؤ, اور ساتھ اگلا فکرہ کیا ہے کہ اگر تم چار گواہ نہیں لا سکتے تو تم جھوٹے ہو, اور اللہ کی نظر میں بھی جھوٹے ہو. یہ اللہ کا نظام ہے کہ ایک سٹینڈرڈ آف پروف جب مقرر کر دیا گیا ہے, اس سٹینڈرڈ پر اگر ایویڈنس نہیں آ رہا تو کنوکشن نہیں ہو سکتی. تو یہ بات آپ نے اس کو ذرا سمجھ لیں, کیونکہ ہم نے بہت 70 سال اس میں ضائع کر دیے ہیں. 1951 میں ہم نے کہا کہ جھوٹ بولنے کی اجازت ہے, اب 2019 میں ہم نے کہہ دیا ہے کہ جھوٹ بولنے کی اجازت ہرگز نہیں ہے. تو اب سب اس بات کو ذرا اچھی طرح سمجھ کے اس کے اوپر چلیں. ایک اور بات جی, تفتیشی افسر کا کام نہیں ہے کہ جو ایف آئی آر میں لکھا دیا ہے مدعی نے اس کو ثابت کرنا ہے کہ صحیح ہے. تفتیشی افسر کا کام یہ نہیں ہے. تفتیشی افسر کا